Thanks so much for being here tonight for our program with Kelli Jo Ford and Diana Abu-Jaber. As I mentioned before, I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. And before we begin tonight, I wanted to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. These are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Thanks so much for being here. We're really excited for our event with Kelli Jo Ford and Diana Abu-Jaber to talk about Crooked Hallelujah. Tonight's event is presented in partnership with the Seattle City of Literature and Third Place Books. And we are also very grateful to tonight's event sponsors, the Seattle Public Library Foundation, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, Seattle City of Literature, and the Seattle Times. And as I mentioned, as folks were coming in, this is a kickoff for our month of programming around Seattle Reads, and the 2020 selection was There, There by Tommy Orange, and we had originally hoped to host Tommy in person back in May, and you know, plans changed, but I am delighted that we are still able to do a full slate of programming celebrating Native and Indigenous voices. And so tonight, you know, we're excited to talk about Crooked Hallelujah, and I also wanted to mention we have a few other programs that are coming up. We're doing an evening with Kuik, which is a Tlingit band from that was founded by Preston Singletary, the amazing glass artist. They're going to be talking about their music, sharing some of their music on October 14th. So that's a week from tonight at 6 p.m. And then we have a program with Tommy Orange with Dr. Christina Roberts, who is the director of the Indigenous Peoples Institute over at Seattle University. And that program is on October 17th at 7 p.m. And we're actually going to be streaming that program live to our Seattle Public Library Facebook. So you don't even need to register for that. You can just go to Facebook and watch it right there on the library's Facebook page. And of course, we also have another program with Keith and Chenoa Agawa for their book, The Whale Child. And that is actually a book that is for kids age 7 to 12. And the authors are part of Lummi Nation, one of our local steward tribes. And that event is on October 27th at 2 p.m. So for folks that have kids and are looking for ways to spend the afternoons with them. I think that'll be a really, really great event. There's more information on all of these programs at the library's website, spl.org. And so I hope that all of you will join us for any or all of these programs. I think it's gonna just be a wonderful slate of programming. I wanted to mention, we're going to get started in just a minute, but I wanted to invite you to take a look at the bottom of your screen, your Zoom screen, and you'll see there's a Q&A box at the bottom there. And so as you're thinking of questions during the tonight's conversation, feel free to ask your question in the Q&A box, and there'll be time for your questions at the end of the program. So go ahead and pop them in when you think of them, and we'll get to them at the end of the event. Now, however, I am delighted to introduce this evening's guests. Kelli Jo Ford is a freelance writer and editor who also teaches at the Low Residency MFA program for Santa Fe's Institute of American Indian Arts. Her story, Hybrid Vigor, am I saying that right? Is it Herbrid Vigor? Maybe I'm saying it right. Won the Paris Review's 2019 Plimpton Prize. And the manuscript for her debut novel, Crooked Hallelujah, won the University of Central Oklahoma's 2019 Everett Southwest Literary Award. Kelli Jo has been awarded a National Artist Fellowship by the Native Arts and Cultures Foundation and Elizabeth George Foundation Emerging Artist Grant. And we're very grateful to Elizabeth George, who's a local writer. We love her. Adobe Pisano Fellowship. And also Kelli Jo won a Catherine Bakeless Nason Award in Fiction by the Breadloaf Writers Conference. And she'll be speaking with Diana Abu-Jaber. Diana is the author of a number of books, including the memoirs, The Language of Baklava and Life Without a Recipe, and the novels Arabian Jazz, Birds of Paradise, and several others, but also just released this year, her first novel for youth, just released in March. It's called Silver World. And Diana's second novel, Crescent, won the Penn Center Award for Literary Fiction and the American Book Award. Diana teaches writing and literature at Portland State University and divides her time between South Florida and Portland, Oregon. So tonight, Kelli Jo and Diana will be talking about Kelli Jo's new book, Crooked Hallelujah, a novel and stories about four generations of Cherokee women. Without further ado, thank you so much for being here. Welcome, Kelli Jo and Diana.
Thank you so much, Sasha. And thank you, Diana, as well. I'm thrilled to talk to you tonight.
I'm delighted, Kelli Jo. I'm really happy to be here and to get to hear you read your wonderful work. And I think you're going to start us off. Yes, you're going to read a section from Crooked Hallelujah.
Absolutely. Yeah, I would love to start with a quick reading. And I want to say quickly hello to everyone who's joining us. And thank you so much for coming to hang out with Diana and I and also hear me read a bit. I will start from the first story. It's just a couple of pages. It's actually on the second page. This is, I think of my book as a novel in stories. And this is from the first story or chapter, however you think about it. It's called Book of Generations. And it takes place in 1974 in the Cherokee Nation of Oklahoma, which if you're looking at Oklahoma, it's on the eastern side in the northeast corner. And it's in a fictional town in the Cherokee Nation called Beulah Springs. And I think it's pretty self-explanatory, so I'll just hop in on page 2 here. And I won't read long, just for a couple of minutes. As a girl, Justine had pored over the pictures from Lula's time at Shalako Indian School, trying to see her mother in the stone-cold fox who stared out from the old photographs. Lula's clothes hung loosely, even more faded than the other girls in the pictures, but something about her gaze, framed by short black curls of all things, made it seem as if she were the only one in the photo. If Marilyn Monroe had come of age in an Indian boarding school and had fierce brown eyes instead of scared blue ones, that would have been young Lula. Justine kept the old pictures in a box hidden in the top of the closet, where she kept her Rolling Stones and a mood ring. Other forbidden things. She hadn't thought of the pictures in ages, but she did so now as she watched her mom in prayer. Lula whispered amen, caught Justine staring at her. Granny's out gathering wild onions with Aunt Celia, Justine said quickly. Late in the year for it, Lula said. She unrolled her nylon stockings and wiggled her toes in the air. In the way of Cherokee women, Lula could still make you feel that she held down the earth around her one moment, and then seem almost like a girl the next. Did you do your homework? I swept and did the rugs too. My teeny, Lula said, calling her the nickname that had stuck when Justine's middle sister, Josie, hadn't been able to say her name. Together, they pushed the swing back and let it fall forward. Justine closed her eyes. In the cool air that had come with the night's rain, her mother's warmth felt nice, which made the words she had been practicing feel all the worse. Evenings like this make me wonder how a body would want to set their bones anywhere other than these hills, Lula said. Justine opened her eyes. The two-bedroom house they rented with Granny set on the edge of Beulah Springs, the outer walls almost as much tar paper as asphalt shingle. She had her own room now that her sisters had married themselves out of state, but her mother and Granny still split a room barely big enough for one. Hand-sewn curtains strung on a clothesline separated their beds. The low green hills beyond the train track seemed like folds in a crumpled blanket after her sister sent her pictures of the Tennessee mountains. Justine had a good idea why a body might light out for other hills, other lands. I talked to Daddy. Her nerves blurted it out for her. Lula put her feet down to stop the swing. Justine couldn't read her mother's face, but she wished she could put the words back in her mouth, swallow them for good. Thank you.
Wonderful selection. I love the way this book begins, and I'm so excited to get to help you present it to your audience. I feel like there's so much richness, and that section that at the opening really conveys a kind of sensuality that I feel is throughout the book. It's subtle. And yet it's there, it permeates your prose. So we really feel the land and the awareness of what it's like to be of a place. And I wondered, Kelli Jo, maybe I feel like all stories have a story. Like there's a story behind how we tell something, how we come to write something. And I wondered if you would share a little bit about your journey into this book and how you came to be there.
Sure, thank you. Thank you so much, Diana. This book started as just me setting out to try to write one story at a time. I was interested in short stories and didn't really have aspirations to tell a bigger narrative. Mm. But as I was pounding out, I was working with Alan Chuse at George Mason and studying art stories very intensely. He was wonderful. He was a wonderful mentor to me, and I was working hard. It's really funny now looking at the book. I was working hard then when these stories first started coming, like on eliminating exposition. That's what we were working on so much. But I was just working on one story at a time. I wanted to write a good art story, and then if I felt like I had one that I could call finished for now, I would want to write another. But they all seemed to be coming from the same places. First of all, I was writing stories that took place in the Cherokee Nation and stories that took place in North Texas. Okay. And eventually they began to come from the same family. Hmm. And I was pretty hard-headed about it, thinking of myself as a short story writer, but it became clear that when you put these together, they were really trying to tell a bigger story. Hmm. So then it became, you know, then the challenge, aside from to continue to piece together one story at a time, the challenge became to see what the best version of that broader story was, if that makes sense. And so to figure out where to start, and I'm so glad you like the opening that you mentioned that, because that story took a couple of years to get right, because I felt like it was one of the first times I felt like I had to write a story with a purpose, you know, and it was I had stories that in terms of chronology, start earlier. I have stories where the great grandmother's a little girl at an orphanage, for instance. So I just tell it, like writing these stories.
Yeah.
And so it became a matter of paring away. And then once I pared away, and then like sort of like filling in what gaps are okay and where do I need to pick up the story and fill some spaces. But so the first story felt very hard because I felt like I needed to introduce a place and this particular family of this place. And as well as a culture and a very particular religion, you know, I wanted to give the reader, because these were things that were going to be carried throughout the book. And so I felt like it was doing a lot. And also I couldn't let go of the idea of a roller coaster. So
the roller coaster, right?
I just couldn't quit. Like I think the story would have been easier if I had not been intent upon bringing the roller coaster in, but I couldn't, I needed it, but.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that roller coaster is essential. I mean, it's such an important motif in the book. You need that.
Yeah, and it was a story. I did. I worked on it for over 2 years. Not 8 hours a day. I would work on it and put it away and work as you do. But but it was also a story where I got to that last line, where I had like the generations together, all, three generations, almost four, and they were going over the hill in the car, and I knew that that was it. So I just knew that I had to figure out how to get there, because I feel like that rarely happens for me. I don't feel like last line, or I don't know. I don't feel like last lines are gifts, but that last line felt like a gift, and then like came the work.
Such a perfect last line. I mean, it just, you know, it does so much work for the book. It's wonderful in that way, because the book is so rich. And if people haven't had a chance to dip into it yet, you know, you're covering a number of generations here of women, and then also you're tying in so many themes while you're doing it, so that the ending is, it's a great kind of punch, you know, and it's just the right note to end on, I think. But that's interesting to me that when you went into it, you weren't really thinking about it in terms of a novel then. It was more incremental, would you say, a cumulative kind of a approach?
I do. I think it was cumulative. I think that when I realized I was going to be writing about this family, one of the earlier stories in terms of when it was written was one of the stories from the last third or so of the book, Bonita, which is a story about a wildfire. Yes. And Justine, the characters are, the main characters are really Renee and Justine. And Justine is a mother who we meet as a teenager in the little section I read, and her daughter, she gets pregnant in this first story, and her daughter is Renee. So in terms of when I wrote the stories, Bonita is one of the earliest stories that made it into the book. Mm. And that's a story of Justine facing a wildfire. She happens to be on that day thinking of her leaving her husband Pitch, and then comes a wildfire and she has to make different kinds of decisions. But once I found Justine in that story, I felt like I wanted to tell Justine's story. And I also soon realized that if I was going to tell Justine's story, I was telling Renee's story, her daughter. And if I was telling Renee's story, I was telling the story of the great grandmother.
Right.
You know, and then right. Lula, Justine's mother, is naturally like, they're just so intertwined in one another's lives. I knew that if I was writing about any of them, in a way, I was going to be writing about all of them.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it was essential to the characters, I believe, but also it was probably essential to my interest in, you know, writing about mothers and daughters.
Right. Yeah. Do you feel like this book belongs to one of your characters? Because sometimes, you know, a book does that. It fits within the center of one character. Would you say one of your characters, this might be a kind of a personal rather than an artistic question, do you feel like one of your characters is in charge of this book?
I do not know if I feel like one of the characters is in charge of the book. When I think about whose story I'm telling and I think about where we start and where we end up, mm-hmm. I feel like in a great way, it's Justine's story.
Yeah.
Because of the nature of her character, she's a character who fights so hard to make a better life for her daughter.
Yeah.
And works so hard, but in great ways, she's being acted upon by forces that are just so much greater than her, yeah. Be it the work situation she finds herself in, you know, intergenerational trauma she's working to escape, though she would never be conscious of that or those terms. And in thinking of it in those terms, she would probably feel like that is a weakness somehow. I don't know that she seems like a character who's so strong, yet she's acted upon throughout the book. But often I've heard from very close readers who feel like it's Renee's story more than Justine's, which was always interesting because I'm like, really interesting. I feel like I don't know. I just think they're kind of like, there's one part in the book where they're described as like two parts of one whole, and maybe that's why.
Yeah,
either could be the case. That.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they are. They kind of, there's a mirroring that goes on, and they share so much energy in the narrative, and you have a wonderful line where I hope I'm getting this right, that Renee says that after meeting all these, you know, hearing about soulmates, she mm-hmm. finds her soulmate is her great grandmother, mm-hmm. Granny. And, you know, I love that you show how the generations bend back and how it's not time's arrow that goes straight forward, but rather the generations of women talk to each other. There's a kind of continual communication that happens. And I feel like that plurality of voices is so much a part of the vision of the book. that it's told through many voices, even though Granny, you know, she isn't alive through a lot of the book, yet she's a real force in the book. And to me, that was really special part of your vision. You know, my own background, my dad was an immigrant. He was an Arab immigrant from Palestine, and my mom was Irish, but I was raised in this country. And so I feel like that hybrid, you know, people call it mixed blood, that vision is really a very important part of the way I see the world. And I felt like I saw that in your writing too. And I wanted to ask you about that. You know, is that something you connect with, that mashup of cultures, or is it not? Perhaps not.
It certainly is. You know, one way that I describe the book is that many of the bones of the book are inspired by how I grew up. So I left Oklahoma, I left Cherokee Nation as a little girl, and moved to North Texas. You know, so when early in the book, Renee as a little girl is standing on a hay bale looking across the Red River at Oklahoma, you know, she's in Texas now and she's looking back at Oklahoma, just sort of staring and wondering if anybody's looking back from the other side. You know, I mean, and I feel like I, in a great way, you know, that Rini isn't me, but in a great way that felt true to my experience as well.
Mm-hmm. Bridging places, bridging sensibilities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Becoming firmly rooted in a way for a time in one place while you're looking back longingly at another. And I think that reflects probably many of our experiences, but you know, even as I've grown up, you know, I feel like I feel like that's often how I can appreciate something is in a rear view mirror. And I don't know if that comes from, you know, lack of cultivating mindfulness, or if often it's a result of if you have an existence when you're young and you move and you leave the things that you know best and that are safe, and you formulate new stuff, and then you move on.
It almost seems an inevitable part of, you know, being between cultures, that, you know, there's loss is just a part of it. Mm-hmm. That loss of place, loss of home, even while a community forms. And I think that the community continually recreates itself, you know, and you show that in the book, that these women are people who have experienced dispossession and really suffered. They've suffered domestic violence. They've suffered economically. They've suffered environmentally. And yet they have recreated and recreated and recreated. And in some ways, more effectively, more healthfully than others, but they do recreate that family. It's continually there and sustaining them. But there is always that tinge, that melancholy, perhaps a sense of grief. And to me, that's part of what makes the book so exquisite, that it holds a space for grief, mm-hmm. You know, which I just feel is so important to this kind of, you know, I almost feel like it's a kind of testimonial. You know, this is what it's like. This is where I come from. This is what I've seen. This is what I know to be true. And just appreciate that so much.
It's really, really beautifully put. I'm sorry, I might have cut you off a little bit, but I just wanted to say thank you. That's really lovely to hear. And I don't think I've heard it in quite that way. But I do think it creates a space for grief. And And also there are times when the characters are at odds with one another, but they even, those are some of the hardest times in the book, I think, for the characters. And also it's when the narrative shifts and you get different perspectives outside of the family, you know, when Rini leaves, and then we get kind of a different kind of a story, because I think that both characters, when they do not have one another, their worlds are not all right.
Yes.
But I guess what I was going to say is that it does create a space for grief. And I also think kind of a communal, it's a shared grief. And in that act of sharing, I think is also beauty and strength.
Yes.
And like a continuation, you know, I heard different readers say, like, at different times while I was working on, like, boy, this is kind of a, you know, these women, they go through a lot of hard times. This is kind of a struggle. And, you know, that's not really what I was focusing on. Like, these were, I think that what pulled me through the book, and what I hope readers can connect to as well, and what can pull readers through the book, as well as the struggle and the trauma, is the strength of these women and their resilience and their determination to make a better path for the next generations.
Yes.
You know, and for themselves, but they're always looking out for one another, and like this connection and this kind of a ferocity, I think.
Yes.
You know, so it was so funny. The first time I heard that, I was almost surprised, like, oh, because it just, you know, I was deep in the work, and to me, I was just working toward these characters and their connections. Mm-hmm. And I guess I did run them through some ringers, but
hey, you know, reality.
Right.
And it must be so interesting to have your book coming out at such a politically and socially volatile time as we're in experiencing right now. You know, to me, there were scenes that I was reading in the book, particularly around the wildfires, where I felt like it was almost like you had manifested or somehow, you know, been in touch with some kind of energy in the world, that you were able to write about things so presciently, like you could see what was happening in this. I don't know. I don't exactly know how to put it, but I found it a little bit eerie. Do you ever find like you write something and it comes true?
Oh Lord, I hope not. No,
right?
I don't think so. But you know, but so that those wildfires and all of that stuff, I feel like, you know, we have been manifesting this reality for quite some time. Mm-hmm. The inspiration for that was my mom did have wildfires bearing down in her house.
Uh-huh.
You know, like the plot of that book is made up. But again, that kind of emotional truth of being on the other side of the country from my mom,
yeah,
as a wildfire was just sort of just ripping through the region. I mean, and went through, like, destroyed towns. A small town nearby that was just down the road was wiped out. And there were times when it seemed that my mom's town might be wiped out. It so happened that it shifted.
Mm.
But that emotional, you know, like that emotional truth, as we say, was there, of talking to her and being unable to get there. And what are you going to pack? Stop packing. None of it's important. Please just leave, you know? And so that kind of, and then I think that, you know, later in the last story, what good is an ark to a fish? That please just leave. None of this is important. You know, that's, again, that's this emotional truth of living through wildfires brought on by drought, you know.
Yeah.
So I feel like we've been manifesting this reality for quite some time.
Yeah. It's just a matter of actually seeing it, acknowledging it, and bringing it into the work, making mm-hmm. it part of the worldview. And I wanted to ask you about motherhood. I know that you are a mother. Mm-hmm. As well as a writer, and motherhood is a really important, I mean, it's sort of the, I don't know, the standard bearer. It's the presiding spirit of your book, if I might say so. I felt like it really spoke to me, you know, as a writer and a mother. I really felt like I was so interested in seeing how these women talked to each other and related. And one thing I wanted to ask was, do you feel like, do you see a division between, or a connection perhaps, between the way white America looks at motherhood and the way the Cherokee Nation looks at motherhood? Because I feel like the book is doing this kind of work of looking at what motherhood might be, and it's playing against our expectations, but who's reading the book? And then the reality of what motherhood is. And I wondered if you could speak to that a little bit.
Sure. I don't, it's a really good question, and I don't think that I have a really good answer for it. And, you know, I feel like with many things, like having grown up away from the Cherokee Nation, my experience with being Cherokee feels very personal, and not as big and expansive as you know, I wish it were, I think. But I do think there's this sense, as I was talking before a little bit about the women's relationships to one another and carrying one another through, that feels like a responsibility to one another, yeah, both the younger and the older generations, that I don't know that I always see reflected in mainstream or white media. And I'm certain that it's there in places, but it maybe there's something in that that feels a little bit different, in that, you know, I often describe, I'll talk about myself for a moment rather than the characters, but I often say that I feel like I was carried here by my grandmothers and my great grandmothers and my mom and my aunties. I'm the first person in my family to graduate from college, like Rini in the book. And I feel like knowing that there, even though we live far apart, knowing that, I feel like there's this reverence and this responsibility that and also maybe I don't think debt is the right word, and I'm losing myself a little bit right here because I'm not sure that I have fully formulated thoughts.
It's okay.
Yeah, but no,
good.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't want to go too much further, I guess.
Yeah.
But I think that's a really good question and something that I would really like to think more about.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just something that, you know, as I was reading, it just kind of kept coming to me. The idea of what a mother is meant to be. What does a mother owe us, if anything? And what do we owe mothers?
Right.
And we put so much on mothers. There's such expectation, and it's so huge. And so it was just fascinating to look at how these women confronted it and talked to each other about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you talk about how Justine and Rini kind of complete each other in a way that even with, you know, a good guy thrown in there, you know, Pitch comes in and we have moments of family and an extended family, which are wonderful, but you always have that core. There's always the core of the women. And yeah, it really struck me and stayed with me as I was reading. I feel like, you know, you were writing from real emotional depth, that there was a kind of almost rawness and immediacy that I felt in the book, in your narrative voice. And I wondered, was it hard to do that? Was it hard to draw on that kind of emotional truth? Was it scary? How was that for you?
There were times it was really hard. And, you know, I think about from that first Justine fire story that I mentioned until the book was finished was more than 10 years. And that's in part because, you know, I didn't have a vision for the book when I first wrote Justine's story. I was just writing a story. But also there were times when I did have a vision for the book that some of the stories that had domestic violence, especially involving a child being a part of that or witnessing it, became really hard to write and sit with. And there were times when stories like that were really a struggle, and I would just need to take time and space, and particularly as a new mom myself. And once I had this like brilliant, compassionate, goofy little girl, writing those scenes suddenly became so much harder, you know, to imagine to have this goofy, brilliant, silly little presence before me, and to imagine one of those in this very, very difficult scene of seeing maybe her mom in danger and feeling like she needs to protect her mom or something. Like, all of that became pretty challenging. So there were times when I just needed to take space, and I took it, you know. I took it.
Yeah, that's the way to do it. Mm-hmm. It's something that, you know, students ask me about this a lot, and we're almost out of time, but maybe just to finish up with my piece, students often will ask about daring to write about certain stories. And perhaps people have come to you with this as well, that they're afraid of upsetting people, that there are certain stories they feel they cannot tell. And it doesn't matter if it's fiction, nonfiction, memoir, they just feel like they can't tell that story. And of course, it's the most important story. But they are terrified of hurting someone or losing someone or some kind of dark energy. And do you have any advice for writers in that regard?
Sure. I mean, I think each person has to go into those waters really on their own. And it's good to have a mentor. And it's good to have someone you can talk to about it. And it's probably good to have a therapist or a spiritual advisor of some kind, honestly, because I think if you're writing about people from communities who are not often represented, there's also a different kind of burden, you know, that you want to... We don't get a lot of stories out there. You know, so you think about the story that you're telling, and in a lot of ways that's not fair. You know, we should all be able to get to tell the story that we're compelled to write. But I think that I don't know that I would have good advice, because I feel like each particular instance of a student feeling or a writer feeling like they have the story they need to tell, but they're afraid to tell it. I mean, I think that I would say write it, and then you can decide what you want to do with it.
Yeah.
And, you know, and try to be true to the characters on the page, and maybe hopefully you have a relationship with the whatever you're afraid of, you know, in a way that you can confront that in a way that and deal with that in a way that feels honest and genuine as well.
Yeah.
I don't know. I feel like it's really hard.
It is yeah. Hard. Yeah. But isn't that what makes it worthwhile? But you know,
I think it is. And those are often the stories that I think are the most moving, are the ones that come from those places.
Yeah, that's right. I
do, you have time to say what your advice would be, what your advice is to students? I want to hear now.
Gosh, you know, it's a tough one. And I've actually had students tell me that they were waiting for someone to die. You know, mm-hmm. I can't write this story till my grandmother dies, or someone. And I've seen that it's really shut down some people, that the fear of that kind of loss, you know. And I just tell people that we all have a right to our stories. We all have a right to tell our story. And we have to hold on to that. And I think, you know, for those of us who are bridging culture, that can also be kind of a fear. Like, am I qualified to tell this story? If I am not 100% this or 100% that, do I still get to tell a story? Mm-hmm. And then you find out, well, yeah, that's your story, is that place right there. Right. So, yeah.
That's good. Thank you. Yeah.
Oh, thank you, Kelli Jo. Thank you. There's a little person over here who is waving at me through the door. I'm supposed to be putting her to bed right now. So I'm gonna turn you over to the audience questions. Thank you, Stesha. Thank you, Kelli Jo. I so enjoyed talking with you.
I mean, it was an honor to talk to you. I loved it. I hope we get to meet up outside of this computer land one day soon. Yes. Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much. Let's take it on the road, Kelli Jo.
For sure.
All right.
Have a good night. Sweet dreams to your little person over there.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. And thank you, Stesha.
Thank you so much, Diana. Have a wonderful evening. And Kelli Jo, are you ready to take a few questions from the audience?
I would love to. Yeah, thank you.
Great. So I will just pull these up here. So Jennifer says, hi, Kelli Jo. Great to see you. In what order did you write these stories? And loved hearing you read too.
Oh, thank you, Jennifer. I wish that I were there so I could go hang out with you afterward. But thank you for joining us. So the order I wrote the stories in, I think that in the book, the earliest story that I wrote was Bonita. Let's see. And the first book was one of the later ones. And some of the books, some of the stories when Rini's a little girl, like The Care and Feeding of Goldfish, that was a later one as well. So some of the stories that are earlier in terms of the chronology of the book were some of the later ones that I wrote. And really, I think the last, other than Consider the Lilies, the last three or four stories were the earlier stories that I wrote. So I kind of understood the end of the book before I figured out the beginning.
Do you want to talk a little bit more about that, how that process worked for you, like knowing the end but not knowing the start?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, it was as I was talking with Diana earlier, it was kind of a matter of like, you know, chipping away the marble to find mm-hmm. the right piece underneath, because I had earlier stories that, you know, the great grandmother in an orphanage as a child, like, and there was a version of this that I thought might have that as a prologue. I had stories when Justine was a younger girl with that really featured the great grandmother. So there were versions of the book in which the great grandmother was a more physical presence. But when I realized that it seemed like Rini and Justine were really the main narrative that were going to carry us through the beginning to the end, I really had to like pare away some of that stuff. So
yeah. I like that image of chipping away like a sculptor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because there was a lot there. You know, I worked for so many years on these stories before I realized really what I was doing.
We have a follow-up from Jennifer. Did you think about subplot, or was the construction of each story a bit more organic?
Sure. Thank you, Jennifer. I think the construction of each story was really a bit more organic. I kind of thought of the overall plot as a movement that was very character driven, you know. And I understood that the women would leave the Cherokee Nation and that they would go to North Texas and that eventually they would be separated to come together at the end. So I guess I understood that, you know, that's kind of the basics of a plot, I guess. But I really did. I thought of it almost like the book is sort of currents and we're pulled along by Rini and Justine and their relationship and they go through things, but it's that is kind of was my ultimate focus.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So we have a question from Ruby. Kelli Jo, will you talk about the process of discovering these families, these characters? And I'm doing that because the word is in quotation marks. And then in parentheses, any tricks? and did you find yourself channeling folks you know in a potentially troubling way?
Sure. Thank you, Ruby. As Diana were talking about the wildfire, you know, and that was one of the earlier stories that made it into the book. And so when I discovered this character, it's a first person story with Justine, and she's this strong woman who's very kind of hardened, and she curses a lot, and she tells you how it is, and she doesn't shy away from much. When I discovered her, that story does not have her daughter in it, but well, her daughter is a presence in it, but Rini isn't physically there. But I understood that their relationship was really important, and I started just kind of almost like in a circular manner working around, like, you know, Rini and Justine, and then as I got to know Rini, I got to know the great grandmother character more, and I don't know, you know, the book is very much inspired by the women I come from, you know, like in the book, I grew up at times in a family with four generations of women, and I was very close to my great grandmother. So it's, these are fictional characters doing made up things, but they're very much inspired by who I came from. And so I think that I was just drawn to the great grandmothers and grandmothers and strong mother-daughter bonds through the generations. And in terms of channeling in troubling ways, I don't know, Ruby, we might have to take it offline. I'm not sure, but you know, there are certain things like the story that is voiced by, it's essentially like a journal entry from the great grandmother. I have some of my great grandmother's journals, and you know, and that's not, you know, the story isn't her voice and the situation isn't something from her journals, but so I found this place where she was keep using her journal as a ledger, and she was tallying up her expenses, and she would go to Dude Drain's sundry shop or grocery store and charge things for the week, you know, like 49 cents for Crisco, things like that. But seeing this kind of like this journal being used as a ledger like that for things she charged that cost next to nothing, she would, you know, it said $1 cash, so she had to get a dollar from him that she would pay back when she got her check. So things like that inspired that the great grandmother's chapter, which is a journal entry, you know, which is kind of a made up event and voice and all that, but you do see this little piece of her using the journal as a ledger in there. So
thank you.
Sure.
So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about, you know, your work as a teacher and how that informed your work excuse me, as a writer. You know, how are those things intersecting for you? And particularly, you know, you've been working on this book for some time and crafting it. And so is there influence there? Are they, do you keep them separate?
I don't keep them separate. You know, I just started teaching at IAIA this summer. So that's been, something that I started post pandemic. And honestly, like during the pandemic, my mind has not been fertile for creative work. at all, you know. Mm-hmm. It, for reasons that I'm sure that I don't have to go into, that many of you can relate to. But I think that I do feel like working with students, it's on one hand, like you have to find balance, because, you know, certain kinds of teachers can lose themselves in teaching, because it can be all encompassing and it's beautiful and it's inspiring. So you have to be mindful of saving your creative energy for your hours for your own work, I think. But I also think that working with students and working with their stories and the literature you're sharing with them and that they're sharing with you, that can like be so inspiring and just, you know, get you thinking and get you into your own work in a really wonderful way. You know, when I teach a workshop, I like to, if we do an exercise, I like to do the exercise too, you know, and then I don't talk about it with them. I talk about their work. But, you know, when we have 5 minutes to write, if I'm where I need to be, I like to sit there and write. So all of that is just, you know, I feel like it really stirs creativity. And it can be really symbiotic as long as you can save a little bit of yourself for your own creative work too.
For sure. Well, I was mm-hmm. going to ask you, I see the pages that are like up behind you, and I was going to ask, yeah. Is that the next book? You know, is that?
Those are my husband's poems that he's got Aww. Up there. And then there's also, my daughter drew a cover for his next book. There's some of her artwork there. So
I love it.
Yeah, they're great. My stuff is tucked away all over my desk here, but
oh, I love it. So it's creative work, just not yours in this.
Exactly. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, we have time for one more question here, and I'm just wondering if you, this is kind of an old classic question, but are there particular writers that you that have been influences for you or that you just love? And has I know some people have been having trouble reading during the pandemic as well. And has that been an issue for you? Or are you, you know, if you're not writing, you are reading? Or how is that going?
Reading's been a struggle too, honestly. I feel really distracted. It's hard to turn away from whatever news of the day is pulling at my attention. So it's hard to stay it's hard to pull myself away from the constant steady stream of bad news. So, but it takes a particular kind of book, one that I can just sort of like, I never know. Sometimes it might be really heavy. One book that I lost myself in is was Women Talking. Are you familiar with that book?
No, I think I've heard of it, but.
Well, that was.
Yeah,
that was
Marion Taves, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Is that how you say your last name, Taves?
Yeah, Taves.
At any rate, so that's certainly not a light read, but for some reason, it was just one that I picked up and I couldn't put down. Others. Lily King's Writers and Lovers was so good. And that was, you know, a lot of like personal, heavy personal stuff, but also a little bit of a lighter read. So I'm finding that it has to be the right book for me. Even if I really want to get into it and I'm enjoying it, it might not stick. But then there are certain ones right now that really do. Books that like Love Medicine was a huge influence by Louise Erdrich.
Yeah.
It's Forever and Always. I feel like it's the perfect work of fiction to me. I love the form. And if you read Crooked Hallelujah, you will see that, you know, probably that I, you know, the novel and stories telling, you know, intergenerational tale, very steeped in place. Like, I love that book so much. It's just like, it is the perfect book. How are we doing on time? Are we there? I can keep going.
I love for you to keep going. How about you give us one more thing and then we'll.
Sure.
Thank everybody.
One more thing. I loved Salvage the Bones by Jasmine Ward.
Oh, yes.
It's the first book of hers that I read, and it's my favorite one so far. And I loved that it really kind of gave me, like, strengthened my heart and my courage to go with, like, first person that's steeped in place and very particular to a certain place. And the characters are so rich and, you know, I loved reading that. And I read it at the right time when I was working on Crooked Hallelujah.
It really makes such a difference, doesn't it? Where you are when you read a book. And so I heard something kind of beautiful today, an interview, I'm forgetting her name, but the author that wrote Convenience Store Woman, and she has a new book out called Earthlings, I'm forgetting her name. She was saying that she thinks of it as music, and the music is not complete until the reader takes in the author's work. And so she was saying something about how, like, she doesn't blame the author if she can't perform their music. Does that make sense? And I kind of love that, because I feel like those things sometimes happen, like you pick up the book and it's not the right time, or you know, or it is exactly the right time for you in that moment. So yeah, I thought that was a nice way to phrase that. But well, I'm so grateful for you for making time, particularly since you're on East Coast time, to be here tonight to talk about Crooked Hallelujah. And so thank you so much for that. And I'm hoping that the creative juices are running again for you whenever that works for you. Like, you know, I know the pandemic is making it hard, right?
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm gonna stick with it. Stick with the reading and, you know, and good long walks, and it'll come. I believe it.
Yes. Oh, yes. Yeah. We'll get through it. Definitely. Exactly. And thank you so much for the beautiful book, and because that will help those of us that get to read it. So
thank you.
I wanted to take a minute to thank Diana as well, you know, for her wonderful interview, and to let folks that are here tonight let you know that if you're interested in reading Crooked Hallelujah or one of Diana's books, they're all available through www.spl.org. And our wonderful partners at Third Place Books also have copies of Crooked Hallelujah, and they're open for limited browsing or curbside pickup. And of course, you can always order Crooked Hallelujah or any of Diana's books through their website as well. And that's thirdplacebooks.com. I wanted to also thank tonight's sponsors, the Seattle Public Library Foundation, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, Seattle City of Literature, and the Seattle Times. And of course, thanks to all of you for joining us tonight. Thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. Good night. Good night.